There's no doubt that you at least once experienced failing prints due to poor bed adhesion. This is where the CryoGrip Pro build plates come into play. It promises not only unmatched first layer adhesion, but also low bed temperatures that would finally allow printing of PLA and PETG enclosed without any issues. This would also allow us to more effectively use filtration systems inside the printers and reduce power consumption and fan noises. So because this build plate might have so much potential, I decided to test all the bold claims by making two projects of mine and quite a few ridiculous tests. This video is sponsored by PCBWay. If you need professionally made parts the easy way, make sure to check them out. They offer multiple services, and the one I can suggest trying for 3D printing enthusiasts is printing from aluminum. It is a cost-effective solution to make complex and extremely rigid parts for your projects. Before we dive into the testing, it is important to know that there are two versions of the CryoGrip Pro build plates. The Frostbite version is designed solely for PLA and PETG, and it has the best possible adhesion for those materials. Meanwhile, the Glacier is a universal build plate with a slightly lower bed adhesion, but additionally you can print materials like ABS or nylon. BIQU also provides a more in-depth material compatibility chart for these build plates and shows comparable bed adhesion, which is great to see. I'm mostly interested in the Frostbite version because of the best possible bed adhesion and lower heating requirement that should allow printing PLA and PETG enclosed. It also should fix the unnecessary waste of electricity, and during a longer power loss, the prints won't come off a build plate. Plus, if you work in the same room, you know how tempting it is to close the door and reduce the annoying fan noises. So as you see, there are quite a few very important reasons why this plate might be the game-changing. But is it? To answer that question, I designed a small and portable soldering fume collector with HEPA and activated carbon filters. I thought I would be printing everything on the X1C, but quickly ran into an issue where the micro LiDAR couldn't properly detect the plate and always pause the print. I proceeded to make all the prints on the P1S, but quickly realized why it happened on the X1C. Turns out that BIQU made these plates wider than the original ones, which makes placing them incorrectly extremely easy. I measured the width of the bed guide stops, and the plate turned out to be just slightly wider than the stops on my X1C. This means that one or another corner almost always will be improperly seated, and you have to be extremely precise when aligning it. The only printer that won't be affected is the A1, as it doesn't have the bed stops that limits the width. I continued the project and started printing all the needed parts from the Sunlow PTG on the P1S enclosed at 35°C bed temperature with the exhaust fan running at 50%. After printing, I checked all the sides of the prints and there seemed to be no lifted corners whatsoever. However, after peeling the prints off the plate and checking with a straight edge, the large prints still showed significant warping. It seemed that now we're limited not by the bed's adhesion, but how well the bed's magnet holds the plate. Because of that, I switched to the Bambu PTG high flow to see if we would see less warping. Unfortunately, I learned an important lesson not to pull parts directly from the plate. You should bend the plate in multiple directions until the parts come off on their own, as otherwise removing those tiny pieces will be a nightmare with such high bed adhesion. The Bambu high flow PTG seemed to have less warping, so I went ahead and printed all the parts except for the main housing. I wanted to test if using basic PLA and printing enclosed would cause any problems. While there was no clogging during the long print, the part still had slight amount of warping. Although this didn't impact the design, when assembled the suction was so weak that I had to redesign the filtration system from scratch. As the room temperature was only 19°C, I printed the new parts with high flow PTG at 50°C bed temperature. The chamber only capped at 46°, with the exhaust fan set to 50%. This is yet another unique aspect of the plate, which allows you to better control the chamber temperatures for more consistent print overhangs and layer adhesion during the cold and hot seasons. With all the parts printed and popped off the plate, I checked how much they warped. Well, yet again, the build plate didn't fully prevent that, all the parts were held firmly in place. You would be a madman trying to print such a large part with so little contact area without a brim on a regular PIA plate. In my case, the small amount of warping again didn't affect the assembly of a soldering fume collector, and everything fit as designed from the first try. But most importantly, this time it worked properly and sucked all the nasty fumes. As I had to reprint the bottom part, which contains a switch and power plug, I can show you why I fell in love with PTG again. To be more precise with the Bambu Labs PTG high flow. While it doesn't have the lay adhesion strength that regular PETG can have, the prints look just phenomenal. It has way less shine overall and the surface of the prints look way more consistent. It seems more like Polymaker's ABS and nothing like the regular shiny PETG. After making the realistic prints and seeing how good the bed adhesion was, I wanted to try something crazier, printing without any heating. You still have to set the bed temperature at least in Orca Slicer, but those were room temperatures that won't require any heating. I found quite a ridiculous model and even then there was no adhesion problems when printing with PLA. Because of that, I made a simple print to test how much force it takes to rip it off a plate. Using PLA, the prints were held firmly in place. However, I noticed that the bed adhesion was lower on the auxiliary fan side. But to be fair, this fan should be disabled if you are using no or low bedding heating levels. Meanwhile, adhesion with PETG was almost identical, but I ripped off the first layer of the print. So if you will be printing PETG without any heating, make sure you are flexing that plate hard until the print comes off on its own. Finalizing my thoughts about the CryoGrip Pro, I think it is actually a game-changing build plate. The bed adhesion with PLA and PETG is simply incredible even without any heating. Now we can make practical or completely nonsensical prints to laugh at the ridiculous bed adhesion and stop worrying about the parts coming loose during the print. The bed consumes none or way less power with those lower temperatures and the print won't pop off after a long power outage. The surface of the plate seems durable even forcefully ripping the prints. However, I wouldn't recommend using a scraper to remove smaller segments of the prints, but rather something pointy and sharp that can lift the corners without digging into the plate. But no product is perfect. First, it can leave imprints from the previous prints on the bottom layers. Those were gone on later prints, so maybe the surface has to wear in evenly, it is hard to say. As you already saw, the plate didn't fully prevent the warping of the more challenging prints. Not because of the plate's adhesion, but most likely because of the many layers that reduce how strongly the bed's magnet holds it in place. So maybe a single-sided coating would be a better option overall. But rather than that, the CryoGrip Pro build plate actually unlocks new game-changing 3D printing possibilities. So while I can highly recommend it, take into account all the advantages and disadvantages before making a purchase. Affiliate links in the video description. Huge thanks to all my Patreon and YouTube members for your continued support. Well, that's all from me, and I'll see you next time.